Good morning, viewers, and very warm welcome to the 23rd episode of the Meet the Media Veteran series. So as you already know, to deliver her third talk of the trilogy, once again, we have senior film journalist, festival curator and author, Ms. Ratnotma Sen Gupta with us. So without further ado, may I first welcome Ms. Ratnotma to the show.
Hello.
Thank you so much, Ratnotma, for joining us again. And audience are, you know, eagerly waiting for your third talk today. So the audience which is joining us first time, let me sort of give brief introduction of Ratnotma to those audience. Ratnotma Sen Gupta is an Indian film journalist, film festival curator, organizer and author. She is the recipient of National Film Award and has served on several international film juries. She is the daughter of scriptwriter Nebindu Ghosh, a leading name in Bengali literature and legendary screen and, you know, a playwright and director. Ratnotma Sen Gupta turned director with And They Made Classics on unique bonding between the screenwriter Nebindu Ghosh and legendary director Bimal Roy. The hour-long documentary has been screened in international festivals and film institutions in Bangalore, Dhaka, Bhubaneswar, Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata, Pune, Ahmedabad, and Guwahati. A very senior film journalist, she has been writing for newspapers and journals and participating in discussions on the electronic media, teaching mass communication students, writing books on cinema and art, programming film festivals and curating art exhibitions. She has written on Hindi films for Encyclopedia Britannica and has been a member of CBFC, which is Central Board of Film Certification under Ministry of INB. She has served on National Film Award jury and has herself won a national award. She has been the editor of an entertainment website, cinebengal.com, and former arts editor of the Times of India, as also the member of the NFDC's script committee. Author of Krishna's Cosmos, several other volumes, she has recently edited That Bird Called Happiness, Me and I, Kadam Kadam, Chuninda Kahaniya, Nebindu Ghosh. May I now request Ratnotma to kindly deliver the third talk of the trilogy, To Be Real or Hopeful, The Moral Dilemma of Director Journalist. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello, my friends. Yes, this is one real dilemma. Not just for film directors, but also it has been for journalists. I will come to cinema, but talking of journalists, let me tell you, very recently there was this super cyclone in Bengal, Amphan, and it made a lot of people go back to the earlier one, Ayla, and that led some others, national and international people, to talk about the dilemma of reporting reality. So how much of reality should you or are you allowed to report? I remembered one incident where there was a bomb blast in Delhi and a young man's body had got severed. The head had got severed and flung across the road. So one policeman had picked up the head and brought it across, and one of our photographers got that shot of the policeman carrying the head. And we all thought that next morning that's going to be on page one. But imagine, I mean, like we inside the newspaper, also next morning we open and we find something, you know, like people crowding around and so on, general. So how often do we get to see something so horrific? And when you're talking about terror, so you want to drive home the terror of the act. But no, the newspaper editors and the publishers and all, they decided, they had a discussion, big discussion, animated discussion, and they decided, no, this is too close to our skin, this is too much reality, and no, we should not have that on the front page, first thing in the morning when people open the paper, newspaper, then start their day. How much of horror is a person able to take, forget willing, able to take when we are not human? We human beings have a capacity, only so much. So when it comes to a newspaper, if this there is a limit to how much reality, when it comes to cinema, which is consider entertainment? Isn't there, or should there, or should not there be a limit to the reality, to the amount of grimness that one film can show? Do you think, as a critic, we have often had discussions, and a lot of people have said, oh my God, too much poverty in that film. Let me tell you, I'm based in Kolkata now. I'm brought up in Bombay, which is Bollywood, which has always been considered to be fantasy-oriented cinema. And Bengal is considered reality-oriented cinema. We are always told, oh, Bengali cinema, too grim, too much always crying, always, you know, too much poverty, too much. Now, when you come to Bengal, you see, yes, there is poverty. But at the same time, this is the city which has been called the city of joy by someone who does not come, who does not belong to Bengal, but who came and spent time in Bengal. That was Dominic Lapierre, and he called it the city of joy because he said, yes, there is poverty, but no, there is also hope. There is a camaraderie. There is warmth among people. So the poverty and sadness is not the last word. So now, coming to cinema, Pothir Panchali, which opened a new chapter in Indian cinema, not only within the country, by inspiring directors like Satyajit Ray, Adul Gopal Krishnan, and so many others. Of course, younger directors in Bengal, Gautam Ghosh, Aparna Sen, and so many others. But what I'm saying is, it opened worldwide a chapter for Indian cinema. But in Indian Parliament, someone who herself was born in Bengal, Nargis, and who epitomized Indian cinema through Mother India, which was about rural India, she had said that Pothir Panchali, it has too much poverty. It is very disturbing to see so much poverty. On the other hand, Pothir Panchali is actually celebrating human warmth, human bonding. It is not about the poverty. It once again, as Dominic Lapierre showed, that yes, there is poverty, yes, there is deprivation, but no, that does not dehumanize these people. It makes them more human. It brings them together. It brings them sort of closer in their emotions. The hardships knit them together. So there is that other point of view. Mrinal Sen's films, yes, there have been poverty. There are films like In Search of Famine. There have been films like Ek Din Pratidin, where a girl has not come back and everybody is worried. And, you know, everybody is worried because of their own account. But at the end of the day, the girl comes back. Is there relief? Now that is the final word. How much of poverty, how much of deprivation? But that is not all. At the end of it, what does the director convey to you? What is the thought he or she leaves you with? Reality itself. Now, Ankur, I mentioned Shyam Benegal earlier. Ankur, Shyam Benegal's first film, it shows exploitation in a rural part of India and Telangana. The husband is deaf and mute. He's a bonded laborer. The wife is exploited by the landlord. She's pregnant. They are thrown out because the wife of the landlord has come and he does not want to be exposed. So he inhumanly he throws the couple out. And they are going away, you know. And everybody knows this is wrong. This should not be happening. So what happens? No one says anything. The landlord who has thrown them out, his conscience bites him. He hides in a dark room and he's crying. And outside, all the people know that this couple has been wrong. What happens? They leave and the child picks up a stone and throws it towards the house that has thrown these people out. And we all feel a sense of relief. My God, at least there is one voice that has been raised against, you know, one little objection, my Lord, said by one voice, a child who's the inheritor of this earth, who's the citizen of tomorrow. So that is hope. That is a warm message that goes out. I was talking about real or hopeful. Now, there are both these terms themselves can be looked closely. We can put them under the microscope. Reality. What is reality? Now, let me tell you, take you back to Rashomon. Rashomon, Kurosawa's film, based on a story, but it's essentially, it's also, it was an experiment, not only in form, but also in the narration of the content, collaboration of the camera in the narration of the content. Now, there has been a rape and then there has been a death. That death was a murder. But was that a murder or a suicide? Was the rape a rape or had the woman induced the man to come to her? So there was a witness. There is a man who is dead, there is the wife who has been raped, and there is a man who has obviously raped and killed perhaps. So now there is a police investigation going on. And all of these, you know, the dead man also through a medium is made to speak, give his story. So there are four different versions. And then finally the police comes to the conclusion. Now, so there are five different versions. And every version, when it is being played out on the screen, when it is being narrated by the characters and it's played out on the screen, the viewer is totally convinced that this is the right version. So, how many versions of reality? There can be as many versions as the number of people involved. Now, finally, is that a sad story? Is that a grim story? Is that a grim reality of how the world is? Is this how every human being behaves? Is that how the film director would like to leave the audience feeling so grim and sad? Or is he, in the conclusion, going to say, no, there are things like this that happen, but no, not everybody is a victim, not everybody is a seducer, not everybody is a liar, not everybody is a killer. There are people, there is a child that is left behind. And the witness who seemed so far to be lying, he takes the child home. So there is, he's not a liar, he's not an evil person. There is a human being and there is hope for humanity. Now, this is a Japanese film. Okay, talking about hope. I'm going to come go keep going from realism to be real or to be hopeful. That dilemma. Dilemma is when a person swings from one end to the other, from one thought to the other. Okay, and so will our talk. I will keep taking you, this was whether a real is real enough. How real can real be? Real can be more real than we think. And then on the other hand, there is a film called Shawshank Redemption. I see that to be the typical Hollywood ethos, hope. If Bengali cinema, I would say, always tries to show reality as it exists around us, which largely is poverty stricken, and there are deprivations and death. Hollywood always ends with a message of hope. There is always something more. And yet, Shawshank Redemption, if you see the film, it's about a man, once again. He has been convicted for the murder of his wife, who was with another person. This was an infidelity, and everybody is convinced that he's the killer. He was a very famous banker, but he's sent to jail. And in the jail, he keeps saying, I mean, everybody asks, what are you in for? And he says, I have done nothing. But that everybody says in the jail. So he's not believed. And the whole thing is how he goes on giving financial advice to the people inside the jail, who are ruthless, uncaring, and you know, they strictly enforce all kind of punishments. And they don't look at the convicts as human beings. They look at them only as, you know, creatures, fallen creatures. Inhuman behavior is all they deserve, is what they believe. And anyway, but when it comes to utilizing his advices, the warden does so and keeps flourishing. He makes a lot of money, and so he wants this guy to remain in jail. Okay, so when evidence shows that he was not the killer, someone else who gets convicted for a lesser crime, one day he owns up and he says that he had killed a man and a woman, and later learned that the husband was convicted. The husband was a very famous banker, and he realized this is the man. He tries to go and tell the warden, and the warden doesn't want this to happen. So he kills up the witness. Anyway, so this goes on, but eventually there is one line there: hope is a dangerous thing. And at the end of the film, we realize why that statement is made. That statement is made because this man, for 20 years he's been in the jail, and there have been men who've been there 40 years and 50 years, and they don't want to go out of the jail. And those who are released, they go and kill themselves. They become so used to this jail. But this man says hope is a dangerous thing. But this banker, after 20 years, he escapes. And the story is not about his escape. The story is about the other man who's been in the jail for 40 years. He remembers, he's suddenly one day released. And he doesn't know where to go, what to happen. He suddenly remembers this banker had said, hope is a dangerous thing, but he had also gone on to say, suppose I'm released. You know, I'm going to go to so-and-so place, that he starts daydreaming. And this man said, oh, who's going to release? You know, I'm never going to be released. He says, what if you are released? What if you are released? So that's a hope. It's a fantasy, maybe, but it's the limit of pushing hope beyond hope. And then that comes to happen. And then he remembers that I will go to so-and-so place. And on a cue, because this man had escaped, this man goes to that place and he finds that man. He had made money. That warden who had killed the witness, the warden was arrested when the banker escapes, and the warden's ill-earned, begotten money he had kept safely, and this banker and this released convict, they get it. So that is how strong hope can be. Hollywood films, so many of them, McKenna's Gold, so many of the war films, so many of the disaster movies, they're all about hope. Titanic ends, the man is dead, but the woman lives. So love lives. And so that is not the end. She becomes an old woman and she lives to tell the story. So love lives. And that is a positive way. In so many of Hrithik Ghatak's films, you know, there is this dichotomy. It seems Suvarnarekha, Meghedagatara, which most people may have seen. The girl says, Dada, ami bachte chai, I want to live, brother, I don't want to die. But she does not speak. I mean, the screen doesn't show her saying this. You know, the tree whirls, the camera shows the trees saying, ami bachte chai. So it's like part of nature. We all become a part of nature. So there is hope. The minute we see ourselves as part of a larger cosmos, there is hope. And, but what happens? Again, in the end, this brother comes back to the basti, to the refugee colony, and he knows the sister is dead, but they don't show it. Hrithik Ghatak, he just shows the brother, stops, because he watches another girl who is trying to walk quickly to the bus stop to perhaps to go to her office, and her chappal snaps and she looks around. It's an embarrassing moment, but it establishes this is how the sister's story had started. The sister is dead, but there are others who might still be going through the same kind of hardship. So there are both, there is both hope and there is realism. Realism very grim, but how the director brings it in also makes it a positive. Lack of grimness, but lack of also hope. Hrishikesh Mukherjee, two films by Hrishikesh Mukherjee, Anand and Lily. Anand dies of cancer. Yeah? The film ends, Anand is dead. But what happens after that, we all know. Amitabh Bachchan, Bhaskar Banerjee says, itne dino tak tu bolte raha hai, bol, abhi you have to speak, go on speaking. And the tape recorder says, Babu Moshai, door upar wale ki hai, haath mein. When we go, how we go, depends on someone else. But we all have to go. That's a note of philosophy. That reconciles us, brings us down to earth, and brings us out of our sorrow, out of the grimness and certainty of death. In Millie, once again, she is with cancer. Like Anand, she was full of life. She was the life of not only the house, but of the building, of the entire community. And she is suddenly with cancer. So what happens now? How does the film end? That there a new medicine has been found in Switzerland. And Millie, husband is taking her to Switzerland. It's an open ending. Will she live? Yes, a new medicine has been found. So we would like to think that she'll live and she'll come back, hale and hearty and chirping once again. But reality, at that point of time, cancer medicine had been found. Today, even after chemo and all, we know it still is a very difficult battle and probably she will not live. But that note of hope. Bimal Roy, Udayar Pothe, so much of hardship. The writer is very poor. He writes a novel which is path-breaking, but it gets, the copyright is stolen. The man who says, I'll publish it, he takes the credit for it. But the sister says, this is wrong. And she opposes. And she leaves the house and comes away with the writer to make her home with him. So that is the rising sun. There is hope of a better tomorrow when a man will not be, a poor man's talent will not be taken away, stolen away from him. There is a hope for a better tomorrow when people who have put in their labor will get paid. Satyajit Ray's Mahanagar, again, the ending. She has lost her job because the boss was being corrupt. He was being immoral. And she stands up for the secretary, and in the process, she has to give up a job. But now her family needs that job. Her family's future depends on that job. And still, she gives up the job, and when she comes out, the husband initially is angry, and then they say, in this big wide city, is it impossible for a couple to make it, make their living together? Is there no hope for tomorrow? Yes, there is. This is a big, bad city, but there is, it is a big city, so there is a chance of our making it. Another film, Wo Chhokri. It was directed by Shubhankar Ghosh, my brother. And the film was about a little girl whose father suddenly goes away. And she keeps hoping to meet her father. Her mother goes looking for the father and finds that he has married. He had political ambition and he has married a political leader's daughter and is now kind of the Yuvaraj of the party. He will be made the party chief after this boss. So he is disowning his family back home, the daughter and the wife. And the wife comes back and realizes that there is no hope and she kills herself. But the daughter says, no, the mother was wrong. She couldn't keep back my father. My father loved me, so he's going to accept me. And she goes looking for him. And one day he comes to that city. She's now reduced to living on the platform. She finds him giving a talk and she goes and says, Bapu, I'm your daughter. And the man refuses to recognize. And he tells his goons who take her away, thinking that, you know, like she's a mad woman. And the father is assured that she's a bad woman and she's been taken away. But he says, no, silence her. And this girl is killed. So many people ask, why does she have to be killed? And then one critic, Subhash Jha, he said that because that is the finality, that is the extent to which the man had not killed his wife, but he kills his daughter, because by now he's an even bigger, he is himself a leader and he has more at stake. So that is reality. More at stake, they become more cruel. But is that the end? No. There are times, there are so many, very recently, another film, Gautam Ghosh's Shankhochil. A man's daughter is unwell. This is a school teacher in Bangladesh. His daughter is unwell and suddenly has to be taken to the doctor. She is with a heart disease, which is they find out at a very last minute, and she is brought across the river to India and taken to the hospital, where things go on escalating, and finally the daughter, on the eve of the operation, dies. Now, meanwhile, what has happened is he has come without any papers, legal papers. He has come without a passport and a visa. And the child is now dead. And they have been admitted by a doctor who's a Hindu name. And they have been given their colloquial names, which are whether Hindu or Muslim, you can't tell. But he happens to be Muslim. And when the child is dead, so because he was called Badal, they assume that he is Hindu and the child is about to be cremated. He says, no, there is up to a certain point I can go. But now the child for whom I had all this while put up with a false identity is no more. And she wanted to go back home. So no matter what I have to face, she will go back home. You please send her back home so she can be buried in her home ground and I will go to jail. The father and the mother are taken to jail and the child is given a burial in her homeland. Now this is reality. This is realism. How much? Here, was there a note of hope? Would that then become hope or would that be a wish fulfillment, a fantasy? If the girl is brought back home, cured. Now that is a wish fulfillment. That is what the parents wanted. But reality is not always how we desire it to be. And I can go on. I'll just talk about two other films. Ballad of a Soldier. It was a Russian film I'd seen as a child, where a young man out of fear, he goes on shooting the tanks that were coming towards him, and he renders them inoperative, so many of them. So the military officer of the unit he belongs to is very pleased, and he's given 2 days leave to go. He asked, what do you want to do? He wants to go home. He's a 16-year-old lad. He's just been brought in because, you know, everybody has to go to war. This is a World War II story. And so he wants to go home and meet his mother and his father. So he's given 2 days leave. And he's going home. The whole film is about his going home. And when he reaches there, the 2 days are over. And he has to immediately come back. That is reality. Okay. On the other side, there is a film, Kanal, where all these victims of the war, they have taken refuge from the Nazi. They have taken refuge in a canal. And the kind of hardship they put up with, oh my God, I would never have imagined that this too is life, this too is human life. And yet, yes, that too is human life. At the end of it, some of them survive and they come out to find that the Nazis, Hitler is dead, the Nazis are gone, and there is sunshine in the world once more. So there is also this. One other film, Separation, Iranian film. I probably have exceeded my time now, but I'll just talk about this and one other American film and wind up. Separation. Husband and wife. The wife wants a good life for the child, and the husband has a father who's amnesia patient now, so he doesn't want to leave his father and go away. So the wife and husband have separated. The child is with the mother. The husband has to engage someone to look after the father. This woman, when she comes in, she's in a burqa and he doesn't realize she's pregnant. Now what happens is, one day the man has gone to work and the father, amnesia patient, he's gone out of the house and is gone missing. So the man comes home and he's very angry, and the woman is trying to explain, and he pushes her and she has a miscarriage. So there is a real dilemma here. Is this right action? Is this wrong? It's wrong on every count. Now, will the wife leave him? What will the judge say? Is she allowed to leave and go away? She has got a job and she can go abroad. What happens now? Now the judge leaves it to the child, the daughter, and the daughter says, no, we will not go. Why does she say that? Because if she doesn't go and stays back with the father, the mother also will not go, and the family will come back together. So reality, hardship, but at the end of it, there is hope, there is life. So repeatedly, I can go on talking about Slumdog Millionaire, I can talk about Three Idiots, I can talk about Tare Zameen Par, I can talk about Mulk. There are so many Bengali films also, Dahan, Ritu Parno's Dahan, and some other films. Hardship, reality. Yes, we want films to show reality. We don't want films to be only fantasy, only animations, telling stories about beautiful lives. But at the same time, we do not want to feel battered at the end of the film. We want that restoring message which says there is life, there is tomorrow, there is sunshine once more, and there is a new leaf and there is a new bird that's going to sing. That is it.
Thank you so much, Ratnotma, for such a, you know, wonderful talk today, and enlightening all of us on this, you know, concept of reality and to be hopeful. I was personally not aware of so much about this topic, but you have really enlightened all of us today. It's really wonderful talk for, you know, cinema students as well. I am sure it is going to help them, especially for the, you know, I sort of see a very, very interesting, you know, PhD topic, what you delivered to today, actually.
it is actually, I mean, like, you know, particularly What is the thin dividing line between hope and fantasy? What is
Right.
the thin dividing line between realism and being realistic?
To that.
You know, there's a world lying in between these hair's breadth
To that.
of difference.
To
And
that.
that is, you. I wouldn't have thought it. Thank you for putting that in my mind. But yes, it is something that we all should talk about more. And
To.
Probably because as a journalist, I had started about journalism. As a journalist, a journalism student, mass comm student, journalism always deals with problem. There will always be problem. It is not a news until you are showing a dark side. Okay, until you are showing that a man bites a dog. But if there is a problem, you have to also show the way out. And that is a very important, very difficult, and very mature role. That is where journalism also has to grapple with this concept of hope and reality.
True that.
And most certainly filmmakers.
True that. That's where the concept of social responsibility for media comes into picture, actually. Whether it is cinema or you are a journalist or you are writing editorial, I think editorial
Absolutely.
Comes with a big bunch of social responsibility.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
There is some light electricity issue just happened few minutes back in my colony, so we'll quickly
yeah.
wind up and I'll quickly sort of
yeah.
have a few questions so that we
okay.
are
sure,
connected.
Sure.
So I was just wondering, to be hopeful. Is it this concept, which forces filmmakers for a sort of happy ending? Is it economics, which force a filmmaker or a producer, this concept of to be hopeful, is it sort of a deliberate attempt in most of the cinema, whether it's Hollywood or the Bollywood?
Can I very briefly touch on the happy ending
Please.
Part of
Please.
Three films? And
yeah.
we can then very easily decide. I'm going to stick to three films written by my father, but we
Right.
can go on to other films subsequently maybe. One is, of course, Bandini, the very famous ending, whether she should go with Dharmendra, a younger man, a doctor who can give her a good life, or with Ashok Kumar, an older man who has deserted her to marry someone and is now sick and ailing. That was a dilemma.
To that.
To have a hopeful, bright ending with Dharmendra or a realistic ending with Ashok Kumar. And the writer and the director, they all went with the realistic ending. That this girl, she has committed a murder. She has taken that extreme step because she loves the man. So now when the man is before her and she realizes he had not deserted, but he had done it for a bigger love, love of the country, because he was part of a group that
right.
had promised that they will take care of the comrades who die fighting for the country.
Right,
and
right.
he had to take care of the sister of a dead comrade who was out of her mind. So that was a bigger love. And can she now backtrack? Will she backtrack? Oh, I forget. He's now ailing, so I go off with another young man. No, she can't. She's a prisoner of her love. So that is a dilemma. Now, economics might have prompted the director to go make the heroine go with the younger of the heroes,
right.
The doctor. But then the whole story then would have to be not about a Bandini. It
right.
should have been something else. The treatment would have had to justify that,
right.
It's a lost love then.
Right.
Then once again, Teesri Kasam. Many
right.
of you would not, the younger lot may not have seen these films, but I keep coming to them because these are timeless. If you have not seen it, you will have to go back and go and see them sometime, because Teesri Kasam is about a gadiwan. He's an innocent man and he's taking a nautanki ki bhai. She's a dancer, but it was the story set in a village, and there at that point of time dancers were considered fallen women, and everybody thinks she's a fallen woman, so why should she not be sleeping with the zamindar? I mean, if he wants her, then she should sleep with the zamindar. She gives up her job, but she will not do that. She does not even marry. I mean, the Gariban has not even asked her to marry, and everybody says, are you a fool? You just go and marry the Gariban, or you go go on dancing. She says, no, this man loves me. I will not break his image. There is a nasha, there is a good feeling in realizing that, you know, he loves me and he thinks of me as a devi. You know, he will not stand for anyone to abuse me. And this zamindar, he has power, and he's going to always think of me as nali ka kira. He will never give me respect, and this man will always respect me and think of me as a devi. So I would rather go away to protect that image. And once again, here Raj Kapoor himself wanted the story to end with her marrying the Gariban, and the writer and the producer in this case, the director was young and producer was Shailendra. He was a very powerful person already. So they said, no, we can't. And the writer convinced, the screenplay writer, who my father, convinced Raj Kapoor that, you see, this is a story. The title itself is Teesri Kasam.
Right.
How can you have a story about a Teesri Kasam if he marries this girl? Then he doesn't take that oath that nautanki ki bhai ko gaadi mein nahin bithayenge. So it's about a love. And Teesri Kasam, the third oath, is his love. He realizes that he loves this bhai and he cannot forget her. So that was the third. And the one where the ending was changed was Do Anjane.
Mm-hmm.
The wife had left him and gone away. She was ambitious. She wanted to be in film. She had gone away with his friend. His friend had seduced her, and he had gone away. She had gone away with him and then become a big actress. Now she's successful, but they had a child. And this child is away from her. And this husband, who was thrown away from the train by the friend and taken for dead by the wife, he lived, he survived, and he comes back. He comes back with a lot of money. He produces a film, and he's shown to be behaving like a stranger. I mean, he's in wigs and all that, but and they don't recognize him. But in the end, the girl keeps realizing it was the story, the film that is being made is her story. And she realizes this is her husband. And she's told that, you know, she can never have her child back. She's repentant. She realizes the man is living, and she's repentant, and she wants to go back and have a child back. And the man says, no, you cannot. In the film version that was released, the boy's parents, the man's parents, they say, oh, no, no, she's the mother of the child, and how can we separate a child? Mother from the child. We are happy to get our child back, so she must get her child back. With the result that the punishment loses its punch.
Interesting.
So there will always be this dilemma of happy ending or sad, realistic ending.
Interesting. So this happy ending, you know, we know cinema is a very costly art form, and you know there are pressures of, you know, performance of economically, yeah. So, you know, we have heard, you know, so many stories when director's vision has been, you know, sort of put upside down. Director has something else as an ending, you know, but suddenly producer, you know, came into force and he says, no, I don't want this sad ending. Please convert into a sort of happy ending, which is basically, you know, to be hopeful. I don't know if this is related to the to be hopeful concept or not, but
yes,
we know
it is story. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so that is why I said that, you know, like how you wind up, how you say, like in Ankur, That little child, one stone, one frame, a little child throws a stone and a message goes out. Or Three Idiots or some of these films, Three Idiots, you know, light-hearted, light-winged, everything. But you go on realizing that this man, this Feng Shu, he was that Ranchor Das, was not his name. He did not even have his identity, but he had a desire to educate himself. And everything, his medal, his identity, everything has been taken away. But his knowledge is not taken away. His knowledge he has taken back to his village in Ladakh and is imparting to the children there. That is hopeful. That is positive. That is one way of showing. The other, of course, is humor. Sometimes humor film. How has Charlie Chaplin shown reality? How has he shown reality of the dictator? How has he shown reality of so many others, Limelight, so many of Charlie Chaplin? It's impossible to think of Charlie Chaplin as merely grim, but it's impossible at the same time not to think of him as a realist. He's not a fantasy writer, filmmaker. So how you reconcile, how you place, that is why I said Hollywood is the cinema of hope. Bengal is the cinema of epitomizing cinema of realism, because relentless, unforgiving realism, or whether you say that yes, there will be problems, but there has to be a way out. Let us look for the way out, and to make it convincing, that is where the screenplay, the director, they all have to work, and the convincing part of the actors, the ability to convince that yes, this is how it can be.
To that. Ratnatma, I have one more question. You know, we know there are so many versions of the reality. You know, a thing which is, you know, sort of real for me may not be real to you. It's very, very subjective, actually. And it becomes really difficult for a filmmaker when he's opting on a historical subject. For example, Gandhi has been opted, you know, so many times by the filmmakers. You know, you remember the controversy developed by the Hey Ram, when Hey Ram was released, and Kamal Haasan character especially, you know. So when you choose a subject, historical subject like Gandhi, or maybe some other subject like Padmavat also you can take, you know, different versions of the reality sort of came into the picture. So how can a filmmaker be real, you know, while opting a sort of, you know, historical subject?
Very recently, because I was translating a piece by a lady on Sati, and I was doing a piece of, I am doing writing on honor killing and Sati and these subjects. I have been looking at Padmavat. I'll come to your Padmavat question first. Padmavat, Padmavati, Padmini, these are stories. Padmini's stories as a little girl. All of us, we've heard some of these stories. And we cannot wish them away, because this has been in the past. But reality, the best thing about reality is not stagnant. It changes. So the reality of Sati, of bride burning, has been changed, has changed. But Roop Kavar happened 150 years after the Sati Act was enacted, making it illegal to burn a bride. Okay, 150 years and more later, Roop Kavar died on the thing. But that was an aberration. Now, Padmavati was part of history. And why did these things happen? What was the raison d'etre? The reason, the thinking was, you see, it's a reality that there were invaders. It's a reality there were fights. These were very powerful military forces. And it's not just India. if you look at Europe, Eurasia, you know, the Ottoman, the Turk and Turkish Empire, all these are reality. They are a part of history. They were mighty fighters. So now what used to happen, Rajasthan and Punjab, these were the states that were always at the forefront. They were the states where the invasions came. Now, so what used to happen in Rajasthan in particular, the tradition had started in Sindh actually, originally. But what the wives used to do, even while the men were there, they would put the tikka and they would send the men. And even before the men had died, these women used to jump into the fire for one reason. So that the men would not worry about the women being taken captives or subjected to misdemeanor. I mean, military forces always used to subject. That was one of the power ways. So to eliminate, to preempt that, women used to do that. Now, whether that is right or wrong, we always look at reality. Like I said, Roshaman, we look at reality from our point of view. Whether Ram did the right thing in sending Sita away. We don't look at so many other realities, that Ram perhaps is the first example where a king is listening to his subject. Is this the first example of democracy?
Right.
We don't look at that. But we, from the feminist point of view, we say he was wrong. I mean, how come? Again, the same situation. Sita says, no, I have already tested once. I'm not going to be subjected to that humility once more. So this is again a feminist voice speaking. We don't realize that. So we go on seeing only one aspect of reality. Padmavat, we were talking about the ending. Can we actually, we might not show it, like Meghadagatara, we might show the trees and not show the women. Actually, the way the film has treated that Johar, he doesn't show the women. Raj Kahini, Srijit Mukherjee's film. Again, he doesn't show the women entering fire. You know, that is in our imagination. We know they go, we end there. But we know the reality because we've heard the story. And we can't do away with that story. Right? So, when there is any such controversy, the most important thing to remember is this was in a different place, in a different age, in a different society where factors, so many factors were different. Okay. And with our knowledge, with our hindsight, we might change the character, but then that's a different story. We can have metaphors. We can have a Padmavati kind of a story set in today's time. We've had so many of these mythical stories happening. Ram Lakshman Sita ki kahani to humne kitni hi Hindi filmon mein dekhi hai. How many Hindi films, Bombay, Bollywood films have told the story, family story of a united family being broken up by a stepmother? How many stories of brothers separated in the Mela? They are essentially stories of partition. India being separated, three brothers separated. It's a story, essentially a metaphor for the partition. So these things are possible. If we choose to be historical, we are choosing to be realistic. If we choose to be hopeful, fantasy, we can go into metaphors.
Yeah. There are so, I have one last question now. We already crossed 55 minutes now. Yeah, you were talking about the characters also, how characters also change, you know, and then there is a blur between the reality and, you know, being hopeful. For example, if you look at the character of Prithviraj Kapoor in Mughal-e-Azam, he's portraying Akbar the Great actually there. But then, you know, after, you know, 30, 40 years, you know, we saw a serial Akbar the Great on television. So if you look at these two characters of Akbar, so Akbar was very fat and, you know, very, very sort of, what you can say, very robust character in Mughal-e-Azam. But in television serial, Akbar was portrayed very thin, you know, sort of muscular guy, director sort of he in interview he said that you know no Akbar was never a sort of fat person like you know Prithviraj Kapoor portrayed in Mughal-e-Azam. So how do you look at the you know this liberty with the reality with the historical character actually?
See, it's very difficult because we didn't really have realistic portraiture at that time. We had miniature paintings primarily. Miniature paintings did show a little bit pretty close to likeness, but these were by court painters and they always idolized. So we, how much can we be, how real can we be? Not as real as the Western oil paintings where the British sovereigns, where Victoria is shown. But even Victoria, when she was young, she was thin, and then she ruled for a very long time. And Akbar in Mughal-e-Azam is towards the later part of his life, and Akbar in Jodha Akbar is in his youth. So in Jodha Akbar, he's again a slim and very handsome young Akbar. And in Mughal-e-Azam, he's towards the end of his life when we all become very matronly and patriarchal. I mean, Shashi Kapoor, forget historical characters. Let's look at Shashi Kapoor. Right. Shashi Kapoor was such a handsome young man, so slim, so vibrant, so active. And in fact, I asked him after Jennifer passed away, he gave up the discipline. He said, why do I need to be in my jeans anymore? I don't have to be. So he gave up. And the entire family had this tendency to become bloated. He did become bloated in his later age. He had put on so much weight, which was unhealthy. So Akbar Badshah, if he was young and slim and agile, it's quite possible because he was a warrior in his young days. In his later days, when he is Badshah, Shahenshah, Hindustan ke Shahenshah, and he has every comfort at his hand, if he has put on weight, even that is quite acceptable, isn't it?
Right. Yeah, no, you are right. But, you know, in Mughal-e-Azam, especially in the beginning, you know, the young Akbar has also been shown till Salim is not born there. So that portion, you know, he sort of maintained the same sort of physique throughout the film. So that was my...
So at that point of time, they did not believe in using younger actors. Like we have in Sardari Begum, you know, we have two different persons playing a young age and why only Sardari Begum? We have so many other instances also where in Slumdog Millionaire also the same character. So many films we have the same character being played by different persons. Maybe if Shashi Kapoor had played younger Akbar, but then Shashi was much too young then at that age. I think he was not yet... a young man, he was probably just a boy then. But not really. I mean, like, yes, maybe someone with vision would have thought of using Shashi Kapoor because Prithviraj Kapoor in his younger days looked very much like Shashi Kapoor.
Right.
There was a lot of likeness.
Maybe, you know, baritone of Prithviraj Kapoor impressed K.A.S.I.F. The kind of voice he had, you know, that was charismatic. No,
and also they probably in those times, they didn't think that, you know, like, see how many of us, you know, like college going Rajendra Kumar, college going, so many of the characters, I don't want to name the actors, but what I'm trying to say is the actors were what, 40 years, 50 years almost approaching and they were shown as college going. But how many of them, like Amir, when he did Three Idiots, he took extra care. He put in extra effort to be slim and he would drink a lot of water so that his skin was supple like a young boy's. And then when he did Dangal, he put on so much weight and so that, you know, even as a wrestler, when he has to wrestle with his daughter, he's out of breath and that is so natural because he's out of shape. So these concepts came in much later. Earlier, an actor... was less of an actor, more of a stereotype, more of a star. And they were taken because of their star value.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So to be real or hopeful, absolutely scintillating talk today by Ratnotma Sen Gupta. And you know, this talk, we don't find this topic, you know, in video domain, especially in YouTube, social media. So I think this is going to be a very, very rare document on this topic for the film and media students. And I recommend, you know, if someone can sort of opt a PhD on this topic, I haven't seen a PhD topic on this interesting world of, you know, to be real or hopeful. I'm sure, you know, many students are going to opt for this topic in one way or other way. And thank you so much, Ratnutma, for enlightening us on this topic today. This
thank
has
you,
been
Rizwan, for this suggestion about the PhD. It's a fascinating thing, and it has so much possibilities. So thank you for suggesting.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think it's a real treat for the cinema students, especially for the film studies students. So that's smart. That I think we have already crossed 1 hour now. So we have to finish the show now. Thank you
we
so
have
much.
To end up. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Lovely talking. Lovely thank talking. You. And I hope the listeners will continue to listen to all your scintillating.
Absolutely. They enjoy the show today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So dear viewers, that much only for today's show. Next Saturday at 11:30, we'll be again back with yet another personality. So please keep watching our Facebook page. That is IMC Manu Official. So all informations will be uploaded on IMC Manu Facebook page. I think we couldn't take much questions today because there was some internet issue in between. Suddenly we lost the connection. And nevertheless, I think we covered most of the points which audience would have been asking in question answers format. But if you have some more questions, you can write on the, you know, Facebook link so that, you know, I'll request Ratnutma again to sort of, you know, get back with the answers.
Answer them. Yes. Yes.
We may continue these discussions in future. So I'll sort of, you know, stop the show now here only because it's like 12:40 now. We'll be back 11:30 next Saturday with yet another personality. Till then, take good care of yours. Goodbye, good day. Stay home, stay inside. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Rizwan, and thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much, Ratnutma, for joining us.